Hey, it's Michelle again. So today we're going to talk about step three of lab work, which is artifact analysis. But artifact analysis can get real complicated real quick, so we're going to break it down into artifact types and talk about how we analyze and why we do analysis of all of those different types. So today we're going to start with pottery, and we're going to talk about why we analyze pottery, how we analyze pottery, and then we'll probably talk again next week about some other aspects of analyzing pottery. So the first thing we want to talk about is, like, why do we do analysis of pottery? And pottery is important because for Native Americans, it was how they cooked their food, how they stored their food, also how they did a lot of artistic endeavors. That some pottery is made very beautifully, and it's made into forms that are animal or human forms that represent ideas of their culture. And then they're also, some of them are very plain and were just very heavy based vessels that could be used for cooking or for storage, long-term storage of different foods. And so we can get some ideas of how, what people were doing at sites by what kind of vessels they had. And we can also look at how the technology of pottery making advanced through time. So I've got this Arkansas timeline here, and I'll put a link to it in the comments below. But in here we have the different time periods of Arkansas, and right between the Archaic and Woodland period, we have a little note that says pottery making begins in Arkansas. And so pottery making sounds fairly easy, right? But we have to remember that in North America, the Native Americans never had a pottery wheel. So all of this pottery is made by coiling pottery, you know, making a long snake out of the clay, and then looping it around and around on top of each other. You've probably done this in an art class sometime during your life, or you will if you're young. And you make those long snakes of pottery clay and just layer them on top of each other, and then you have to seal them together. If you don't do a good job at sealing those coils together as they stack, then your pot will just fall apart. It doesn't hold shape as one vessel. So it's really a really complicated thing. I've made some terrible pottery in my life. So the fact that we get these beautiful vessels that you could never tell had been coiled, they look like just one piece of clay going all the way up the vessel, and then some of them are highly decorated. It's really a technological achievement, and it's very impressive. And we can tell some of that technology advance by the temper that is used in the clay. So temper in clay is just an additive to the actual clay that helps when the clay dries. I'm sure you've seen clay or Play-Doh or something dry, and as it dries, it starts to crack. And if you were making a pot or a bowl or something to cook soup in or to keep seeds in, you can't have cracks in it. Everything will fall out. Things will come out of it. So Native Americans started putting temper into the clay because the temper doesn't change shape and doesn't shrink as the clay around it dries. So it's something to grab onto so the whole vessel can't completely shrink and start to crack. The temper prevents that. So early on, they used sand as temper. And sand, I don't have an example of sand-tempered pottery in my lab right now, so I can't show you, but it makes the pottery pretty sparkly, but it also makes the pottery very heavy and difficult to work with the clay. So you get very large, thick vessels, thick-walled vessels, when you're working with sand-tempered pottery. And they're not particularly decorative, and they don't come in a lot of different shapes and styles because you're just trying to make it work because the clay is very heavy. So to make it good enough that it'll hold its form and be able to dry and be fired, that's kind of what you're doing with sand tempering. But then later, the Native Americans discovered that they could crush up old pottery, crush it up really fine, and that it makes a good temper too, and it makes the pottery, the clay, more workable for the pottery so you can make finer pottery styles. And grog is what that is called, grog tempering. So grog is just tiny bits of broken up pottery in the clay. And I don't know if you can, it's not focusing on this properly. But so you can't really see it. You can kind of see one piece right there, piece of grog. Sorry for the bad focus. But so what you're looking at is just a piece of clay, a piece from a fired pot, or a vessel of some sort, and inside that clay there's just a bunch of tiny little crushed up sherds from another clay pot that probably got broken, and instead of just throwing it away, they took the pieces and ground them up really, really small, probably a little bit bigger than sand, but pretty small, and then worked that into their clay so that the next pot would be grog tempered. And they were able to make thinner vessel walls and more different shapes because this kind of clay, this grog tempered clay, was easier to work with. And so during the Woodland period, we generally see this grog tempering, especially Northeast Arkansas is the region we're generally talking about here, grog tempering during the Woodland period. And then the Native Americans figured out that they could use mussel shell to make an even better temper, that they could make even finer pottery. And in the Mississippian period, they generally have shell tempered pottery. So you can see all those little white speckles on this piece. Maybe you can see them. and that's shell. Those are just pieces of shell. And you can see them in here too, all these pieces of white speckly shell in the side of the pottery. And when we see all of that really finely decorated and designed pottery that you think of when you think of Northeast Arkansas Native American pottery, that's all shell-tempered pottery. So they take the mussel shell, they'd burn it, they'd crush it up really fine, get all of the moisture out of it, and then again, it would work to keep the clay from shrinking and breaking as it dried and was fired. Some of the shell was big enough to see, but sometimes in some of the pottery, it's very impressive. It's ground so fine, you can barely see the shell tempering in it, but you know it's in there. You can see some signatures of shell in the broken edges, even though you can't see a lot of shell pieces themselves. So I think that's where we're gonna end the video today, talking about tempers and that technology change through time. And I will put this, a link to this timeline in the comments. And then next week, we're gonna talk about looking at pottery decorative styles and vessel forms and what that means for archaeologists and why we use that as an analysis type. So thanks for listening, and I'll see you next week.